Thanks, Lindsay.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Lindsay, for that introduction. And thank you all for coming out to our presentation of Brothers in the City. I'm Dan Dillon.
And I'm Dennis Dillon.
No. Oh, yeah. I'm Dennis Dillon.
That makes me Dan Dillon.
We hope to bring back some great St. Louis memories for all of you and maybe tell you some things about our great city that you did not know. And for sure, I'm Dennis Dillon.
And I'm Dan Dillon.
Although I was born across the state in Kansas City, I've spent most of my life here in St. Louis.
Same here.
I graduated from St. Thomas Aquinas High School in Florissant.
So did I.
I received my Bachelor of Journalism degree from the University of Missouri in Columbia.
Me too.
Unfortunately, I'm the oldest, but I am the wisest of the two of us.
It's true, you're older.
I spent most of my career as a sports writer in St. Louis, 12 years at the St. Louis Globe Democrat. And like Carrollton and our old high school, that's no longer there. And then I went to the Sporting News and worked there for 26 years. And I've been kind of freelancing after that. But Dan had a long career here in St. Louis as a TV writer-producer. Coincidentally, we both came out with books last October. My book is called Lost Treasures of St. Louis, the second edition.
And I wrote...
Hold on. Some of you might remember the first edition of Lost Treasures, which was written by Cameron Collins and published in 2017. It was a big seller, but unfortunately, in November that year, there was a warehouse fire at Reedy Press, the publisher, and 200,000 books were destroyed, including most of what was left of Lost Treasures. But it had been such a popular seller that they decided to come out with another one last October, and I was asked to help Cameron write the second one.
Now, my book, The Ultimate St. Louis Trivia Quiz...
I'm not done. The second edition of Lost Treasures carries over many of the popular items that was in the first book, but there are more than 130 new entries that you can read about for the first time.
I have 1,000 questions in my book.
We actually added 2 new chapters in the second edition.
Can I speak for 10 seconds?
Well, obviously, you keep interrupting me.
All right, I know how St. Louisans love their history and their trivia. So I wrote The Ultimate St. Louis Trivia Quiz, 100 questions to help you win contests, amaze your friends, and bend your brain.
Today we're going to do a little back and forth combination history lesson and trivia quiz. I'll pass along some of the fascinating items that were in Lost Treasures of St. Louis.
And I'll follow up with a couple of trivia questions with the same themes as Dennis. And if you want to play along with our trivia quiz, make sure you've got an answer sheet. I think we still got some in the back of the auditorium if you'd like. And we'll give prizes for the best answers today. Okay, Dennis, let's get started.
All right. Our first topic is food and drink. For 20 years, from 1980 to 2000, St. Louisans and out-of-towners alike enjoyed eating Big Macs and French fries on a 19th century riverboat built on top of a floating barge on the Mississippi in the shadow of the Gateway Arch. It weighed 702 tons and measured more than 185 feet in length. It could seat more than 130 people inside and more than 200 on its open air deck. Despite its popularity, not everyone liked going to the floating McDonald's. Some diners thought the food was overpriced, and others thought the food tasted like the river. The Flaming Pit. The first Flaming Pit restaurant opened in 1958 on Clayton Road, across from what now is the Galleria. Other locations followed in De Pere, Ferguson, Crestwood, and at the Village Square Shopping Center in Hazelwood. Menus were on wooden boards that looked a little like children's puzzles, but they showed the various entrees. Back then, you could get a boneless prime sirloin steak for $2.90, two center-cut pork chops for $2.45, and a filet mignon for $3.85. Children could eat for a penny a pound that they weighed, and they were allowed to fish for a prize from a treasure chest on the way out if they behaved during dinner. You know, I remember Mom and Dad taking us to the Flaming Pit several times, but I don't remember you ever getting a prize, Dan.
I did.
Next up, you might remember the Noah's Ark. For more than 30 years, Noah's Ark Family Restaurant at the intersection of I-70 and Fifth Street in St. Charles beckoned hungry travelers to a unique setting that included a giant boat with towering fiberglass animals. Atop the restaurant roof were giraffes, tigers, monkeys, elephants, and Noah himself at the front there, standing 7 feet tall. The entrance to the restaurant had a water-filled moat with a hippopotamus that snorted and spouted water. But the best thing about Noah's Ark was its delicious clam chowders. Anybody remember that? Yeah. Built in 1967, the restaurant lasted until 2000, when the boat and most of its larger-than-life animals were destroyed. Somehow, Noah escaped and was later found wandering aimlessly on I-70. Here's a nice, refreshing treat on a hot summer's day in St. Louis. Not today. This is Black Diamond Watermelons. That was Sam Zibelman's secret to providing the sweetest, juiciest watermelon slices in St. Louis. Sam's Watermelon stand on Natural Bridge Road in North St. Louis was a special treat on a hot summer's night. Under a string of lights, Sam would carve his oversized watermelons into slices he sold for 50 cents each. Crisp, cold, and sweet, the melons had seeds that were perfect for spitting, an act Sam encouraged. And on the right, you'll see a picture of Bob Hope and Sam. Bob Hope made it a habit to visit Sam's stand whenever he came to St. Louis, calling the watermelons the sweetest he had ever tasted. The Bayou Belle, I'm not sure how many of you remember that. It was a steak and seafood restaurant in Bridgeton that operated for 12 years. It was actually a 126-foot steam sternwheeler that had been sitting in a New Orleans bayou and being used as a meeting place for a Pentecostal church group. St. Louis and Obi Koprivica, whose dream was to open a restaurant in St. Louis, purchased the boat for $8,000 and had it towed up the Mississippi River to the Missouri, over to the Missouri, to the old St. Charles Rock Road Bridge. There, it was pulled out of the river, loaded on a house mover, and transported down St. Charles Rock Road and placed on a concrete moat on land that was near the Target store in Bridgeton, about a half mile from where we grew up. Tragically, Koprivica never got to see his dream come true. While renovating the boat and repainting the smokestacks one night, he slipped and fell into the concrete moat. He suffered a massive brain injury and died the next day. His widow decided to push forward with the restaurant, which opened in 1963 and lasted until October 5th, when it was destroyed by a fire. Fortunately, no one was injured. Now, I'm going to hand it over to Dan for some food and drink trivia questions.
Thank you very much. And fortunately, we're not going to have any questions on Obi Koprivica. But we are going to test your knowledge on some food and drink trivia in St. Louis. I think that sugar high from the gooey butter cake should be kicking out, so you should be doing pretty well. By the way, if you didn't get a piece of gooey butter cake from the gooey Louie gooey butter cake people, there will be plenty left over, I believe, after we get out of here. So if you're going to play along, get your sheets ready and your pens up. Here is our first food and drink question. What favorite restaurant on the Hill, established in 1957, is famous for its frozen fishbowl of beer?
No cheating.
Yes, no phoning a friend. Question number two. What late night entree, considered to be a St. Louis creation, consists of two eggs, hash browns, and a hamburger patty, all covered in chili? You had one of these at about 1 o'clock this morning, didn't you?
Yes. Quite good.
They're very good for overnight snacks after you've had a long night at the bars. Number three, what St. Louis product advertised itself as the choicest product of the brewer's art? That was its slogan for many years. Number four, all four of these eateries, the Parkmore, White Castle, Steak and Shake, McDonald's, all four were found along the St. Louis stretch of historic Route 66. Our question is, which one was established first? The Parkmore, White Castle, Steak and Shake, or McDonald's? It might be both, but definitely first in St. Louis. First to make its appearance in St. Louis.
Bob,
number five.
What's Bob, that? Raise your hand the next time, okay?
What best soda product was a knockoff of Dr. Pepper? What was the name of this product that was a knockoff of Dr. Pepper? And finally, just for fun today, every question six is going to be a Dillon Brothers question, just to embarrass ourselves and to let you know a little bit about us. Question six, as a kid, which brother had so many mishaps which sent him to the Menorah Hospital ER in Kansas City that the nurses knew him by name? Was it Dennis or Dan? You got a 50-50 shot there. You can't go too wrong, right? All right, you ready to talk some more history, Dennis?
Let's do it. Our second group of memories are favorite entertainment venues. First one is the Admiral. The SS Admiral was an Art Deco steamboat that was launched as a river excursion boat in St. Louis in 1940. Measuring 374 feet long, that's more than 1 1/3 football fields, it had 5 decks and could carry as many as 4,400 passengers. It offered a variety of food, games, and entertainment, and was a perfect venue for daytime picnics, nighttime moonlight cruises, or just for a chance to relax on the open-air upper deck and watch the world go by. Damage to the ship's hull in 1949 forced the U.S. Coast Guard to condemn the Admiral and prohibit it from cruises on the river. It subsequently was converted into a nightclub and later became the President Casino.
Before you go on, I'd like to add here that the nuns in that picture there, who were probably drinking Virgin Marys on the deck of the Admiral, those are sisters from the St. Joseph of Carondelet order. That was an order that taught at dozens of high schools and grade schools back in the 50s and 60s in St. Louis. As a matter of fact, where we went to high school, St. Thomas Aquinas, they had the St. Joseph nuns there. Anybody here taught by St. Joseph nuns back then? Yeah, not too many left. Now at our grade school in Bridgeton, we had nuns from the...
Come on. Enough. Enough with
the
nuns.
Sorry.
Okay. Next up is Wet Willie's Water Slide. Back in the late 70s, two of them opened up in the St. Louis area, one at I-70 and Cave Springs Road in St. Charles, and the other at I-44 and Highway 141 in Fenton. Sliders were handed 2-foot by 4-foot rubber mats at the top of the slide, and then they slid down these winding, twisting 500-foot slides with banked walls. The slides were a lot of fun, but they were also dangerous. They were made out of concrete, not fiberglass, like many of today's slides. So if you lost your mat, you likely would be bumped up on the sides and maybe suffer scrapes, bruises, or worse, from bouncing off the concrete. In the first month alone in St. Charles, 10 riders were sent to the hospital, one with a broken vertebrae.
You can probably relate to that, can't you?
Adding insult to injury, some riders who lost their mats also lost their suits. This is the famous Forest Park Highlands. With such memorable rides as the Comet, the Racer Dips, the Aerojets, and the Flying Turns, Forest Park Highlands was the premier amusement park in St. Louis for nearly 70 years. Known as the Big Place on the Hill, it was located on Oakland Avenue, just south of Forest Park, about where Forest Park Community College is today. Along with its various spine-tingling rides, the Highlands also had swimming pools and a dance hall. After many years of success, particularly in the 40s and the 50s, the end came quickly when a fire engulfed the park in July of 1963. Only the roller coaster and the carousel survived. The carousel was eventually moved to Faust Park in Chesterfield, where it still is. The arena. This was one of my favorite venues. Few structures have meant more to thousands of St. Louisans than the venerable St. Louis Arena. Located at 57 Oakland Avenue, the old barn was one of the most important buildings in the history of St. Louis sports and entertainment, along with being the home of the St. Louis Blues from 1967 to 1984, the Blues hockey team, that is. The arena was a home venue for several other local sports teams, including the NBA's Hawks, the ABA's Spirits, the MISL Soccer League Steamers and Storm, and St. Louis U's basketball and hockey teams. It also hosted many conventions, concerts, horse shows, college basketball Final Fours, wrestling shows, and more. On February 27th, 1999, in front of thousands of St. Louisans who came out to say a final farewell, the arena was demolished by a controlled implosion using 133 pounds of TNT. And that's what I'm talking about. The Playboy Club. In 1962, Hugh Hefner announced that he was going to expand his Playboy world to St. Louis, where the fourth of his iconic clubs would be built on Lindell Boulevard, coincidentally just a few blocks west of the Cathedral Basilica.
Shameless.
Yeah. The announcement triggered a massive bunny hunt in St. Louis. More than 800 young women applied to be bunnies, but only 41 were hired and sent to bunny school. Any former bunnies here today? No? Okay. The 18,000 square foot St. Louis Club was a place to drink swanky cocktails in mirror-lined rooms and listen to such comic artists as George Carlin, Flip Wilson, Richard Pryor, and Tiny Tim. The most famous St. Louis playmate was Patty McGuire, who was Playmate of the Month in November of 1976 and Playmate of the Year in 1977. She later married local tennis star Jimmy Connors. The Lindell Building closed its doors in September of 1975, but the Playboy Club moved to the South County Ramada Inn on Lindbergh, where it lasted another 10 years before closing in 1985. Dan, are you ready for some more trivia?
I am. Did you ever go to the Playboy Club?
Me? No. No. No.
Mom would be ashamed if you did, by the way. Okay, let's do some entertainment trivia. Let's see how your memory is about some things that happened long ago here in St. Louis. Number one in this round, can you name this guy? He was a former Hockey Blues fan favorite. He played here from 1970 to 1979. He was known just as much for his shoulder-length blonde hair as for his play on the ice. What player was that? The ladies loved him. Question number two. He was the father of rock and roll, and today the statue of St. Louis legend Chuck Berry in the Del Mar Loop includes Chuck holding his trademark guitar, and the brand of the guitar is on the statue. What brand of guitar is it? Well-known brand of guitar. Number three. I know a lot of you remember this guy, who was the longtime TV host of KSD's St. Louis Hop on Saturday morning. I see you writing. I knew you'd know that one. Number four, my favorite question of the morning. What popular St. Louis striptease artist had her chest insured for $50,000 by Lloyd's of London?
Now, I might have gone to see her.
She's still stripping, by the way. She's 97. I wouldn't recommend it. It's not a pretty sight. Number five, it began as the Riverfort Amphitheater. It's now the Hollywood Casino Amphitheater. But what other two names has this venue had? In between Riverport and Hollywood Casino, it's had two other names. Can you come up with one or both? And our Dillon Brothers question. As a kid, which brother would not leave the house for a special occasion unless he was wearing a bow tie? Was it Dennis or Dan? By the way, St. Louis or Dillon family members are exempt from this. You can't play along. You know the answers. It would be cheating. Okay, let's look at some St. Louis media memories of yesteryear. Are you ready?
I'm ready. Okay, Wrestling at the Chase. Very popular show back in the day. It was the brainchild of St. Louis wrestling promoter Sam Muchnick. That's him holding the trophy. And KPLR Channel 11 owner Harold Koppler. Wrestling at the Chase aired on TV from May of 1959 to September of 1983. About 1,100 matches were produced over its 24 years. In the beginning, the matches were broadcast live on Saturday nights and shown again on tape on Sunday morning. Wrestling at the Chase featured many of the most popular wrestlers of that era, including Dick the Bruiser, Harley Race, Gene Kaniski, Lou Thesz, Pat O'Connor, and Nature Boy Ric Flair, Whew. You didn't get that, did you? Okay, no problem. At first, the matches were held in the Coruscant Room of the Chase Park Plaza, where, as you can see in the picture, the diners could sit at tables and eat their dinner while watching wrestling. I took a first date there one time, and after that, she refused to go out with me ever again. Yes, Corky's Colorama. Airing on KSD TV Channel 5 from 1964 to 1980, Corky's Colorama was the first locally produced St. Louis program to air in color. The part of Corky was portrayed by Cliff St. James, who also was Channel 5's weather forecaster. Along with Corky's fun and zany antics, the show featured Hanna-Barbera cartoons, skits, puppets, and tricks performed in front of a studio filled with mostly happy children. Among some of the other children's programs televised in St. Louis back in the day were Romper Room, The Wranglers Club with Texas Bruce, Cookie and the Captain, Mr. Patches, and Captain Eleven's Showboat. Oh, yes, the St. Louis Globe Democrat.
This is a subject near and dear to your heart, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. I worked there from 1973 until 1985. The Globe Democrat was published daily in the morning, Monday through Saturday, while the competitor, the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, came out in the afternoon on Monday through Saturday, and it was the morning paper on Sunday. One of the most distinct differences between the two papers was its editorials view. The Globe Democrat had a conservative voice, while the Post was more of a liberal newspaper. The Globe features such well-known columnists as Jerry Berger, Pat Buchanan, Martin Dugan, Rich Koster, and Robert L. Burns, not Bob Burns, a.k.a. the Benchwarmer.
The Pat Buchanan, that's the famous Pat Buchanan, right?
Yes, it is. Yes. In 1983, the Globe announced that it was going to close. We started scrambling to find out what we're going to do for jobs. But in 1984, a man named Jeffrey Gluck purchased the paper. At first, we viewed him as the proverbial knight on a white horse coming in to save the day. Unfortunately, he turned out to be Snidely Whiplash.
This is where I hold up the sign that says, boo.
He stopped paying some of his operating bills. He stopped paying for our health insurance. In the warm weather, employees had to bring in desk fans to have at their workstations because the air conditioning had been cut off. He started bouncing our paychecks. I don't sound bitter, do I? The paper declared bankruptcy in August of 1985, but then two other men, John Prentice and Willem Franke, resurrected it in January of 1986. Unfortunately, their revival lasted only 10 months, and in October of that year, the Globe closed for good after a run of 131 years.
Oops. One moment, please. Hey, Josh, if you're up there, I need to reset. Oh, here we go. All right. Let me go up here. Sorry about that. Here we go.
Prime Magazine. I don't know if anybody remembers that. Beginning in 1947, Prime covered local high schools and was a fixture in the St. Louis teen scene for more than 45 years. Each issue featured articles written by teens themselves and included photographs and stories about sock hops, football games, and popular school events. With its familiar red cover and 10-cent price, Prime also featured articles about fashion, dating, and other teen-related topics. It was published by Julian H. Miller, who was a big, published by Julian H. Miller, Prime also dealt with drug abuse, an issue that Miller took very seriously. But when Miller started devoting entire issues to drug abuse, advertising began to dry up. As a result, the magazine ceased publication in 1973. You should remember those guys, maybe? In the 1960s, KXOK, 6:30 a.m. on your transistor radio, was the must-listen radio station if you were a teen in St. Louis. It dominated the airwaves and helped pioneer the top 40 music format. It featured a stable of brilliant radio personalities, including Mort Crowley, Danny Dark, Bill Addison, and Delcia Devon. But the most popular program was the nightly Johnny Rabbit Show, featuring Johnny Rabbit and his nerdy sidekick, alter ego, Bruno J. Grunion. The role of Johnny Rabbit was portrayed first by Ron Ells, the man on the right, and later by Don Pietramonico, the man on the left, who was the one who really took the program to its greatest popularity level and is probably the Johnny Rabbit most of us remember. Now get your pens out, because here comes some more trivia.
All right, here we go for some media trivia. Number one, Jack Carney made this affable, talkative cleaning lady into a radio star on KMOX back in the early 80s. Do you remember her name? Who was the cleaning lady that Jack Carney would have on his radio program? She was a real character. Number two, this award-winning journalist wrote about sports, theater, film, wine, and food. He might be best known for his 5 St. Louis restaurant guides. Do you remember his name? Number three. This is the most recent question of the day. In the NBC TV sitcom Superstore, which I think was on the air just about 5 years ago, what was the name of the fictional St. Louis big box chain store? It was situated here in St. Louis. Obviously, they really filmed it in Los Angeles, I'm sure. What was the name of that store? Was it A, Cloud Nine, B, Dunphy's, C, Shop-A-Lot, D, Friendly's? Take a stab if you don't know. You could be correct. Number four, who was known as the first lady of St. Louis TV with a popular women's program first on Channel 5 and then later on Channel 2? Very popular morning program locally here in St. Louis. Number five, what popular TV sportscaster gave out weekly awards for the best, the worst, and the weirdest sports highlights? What was his name? And the Dillon Brothers question for this round. Which brother sucked his thumb until he was 9 years old? Ready to move on?
Let's do it.
Here we go.
Now let's look at some popular attractions that you might remember from back in the day. First one is the Crystal Palace. In the 1950s and 1960s, Gaslight Square, a new neighborhood of trendy restaurants, nightclubs, coffee houses, and taverns, opened up just west of downtown St. Louis and became the center of the music and culture scene in St. Louis. At the heart of Gaslight Square was the Crystal Palace, a gilded restaurant and theater that featured ornate chandeliers and dazzling stained glass. The Crystal Palace was the launching spot for many entertainers, including Phyllis Diller, Miles Davis, Woody Allen, Lenny Bruce, the Smothers Brothers, and Barbara Streisand, who performed at the Palace for 4 weeks in 1961. Unfortunately, by the late 1960s, Gaslight Square had lost much of its allure, falling victim to the rapid growth of St. Louis suburbs, urban decay, and white flight. Phil the Gorilla. When he arrived at the St. Louis Zoo in 1941 as an infant chimpanzee, Phil weighed 30 pounds. By the time he passed away 17 years later, he tipped the scales at a dainty 776 pounds. Phil was named after animal collector Phil Carroll, who brought him to the St. Louis Zoo from the African jungles of what is now known as Cameroon. Known for his mischief, love of orange soda, and epic splashes made when he jumped into his water tank, Phil was one of the most popular attractions at the zoo. In 1958, the zoo announced that Phil was sick and had stopped eating. It became front page news, and visitors flocked to his cage, some of them even bringing them home-cooked meals, hoping that that would start Phil on the road to recovery. Unfortunately, it never did. And on December 1st, 1958, he died. But his taxidermy preserved body can still be seen at the zoo. Pardon me. The spirits of St. Louis. They weren't here very long, so many of you might not even remember them. They were an American Basketball Association team that lasted only two seasons. Although they had losing records in both years, they gave St. Louis fans the thrill when they beat Dr. J and the New York Nets in a playoff series after their first season. Among the most popular players on the Spirits were Maurice Lucas, Freddie Lewis, Fly Williams, Gus Gerard, and that guy on the left, Movin' Marvin Barnes, who was primarily known for showing up late to games and making outlandish statements. After a game one night in Louisville, the Spirits were about to board a plane for the short flight back to St. Louis. It was supposed to leave at 8:05. When Marvin asked what time the plane was supposed to land in St. Louis, a teammate told him 7:56. Not realizing that Louisville was in the Eastern time zone, an hour ahead of St. Louis, Marvin declared, "I ain't getting on no time machine." So he rented a car and drove home. The Spirits also were known for giving St. Louis an up-and-coming broadcaster who would go on to much fame and fortune broadcasting Major League Baseball games, the Olympics, the NFL, and many other sporting events. You probably heard of him, Bob Costas. Okay, Ronnie's Drive-In Theater. This was the first drive-in theater built in St. Louis by the Werenberg Theater chain. It opened in 1948 in South St. Louis County at the intersection of Lindbergh Boulevard and Baptist Church Road. Named for chain owner Fred Werenberg's grandson, Ronnie, the drive-in had a capacity for 1,000 cars and 4,000 movie watchers, if you included all the ones that hid in the car's trunks at the admission gate. Ronnie's featured a large playground for kids at the base of the screen, a miniature train, and a water fountain that changed colors. The drive-in was closed in 1982, but Ronnie's multiplex theater now stands about on the same ground where the drive-in once was. Okay, show of hands.
I know one person in this room today that had made an illicit trip to the Coral Court. I'm not going to ask you to give yourself up, but I know you're there.
Okay. Located at 7755 Watson Road, the Coral Court was one of the most popular sites on the old historic Route 66. Distinguished by its glazed brick and glass block, along with its famous neon and chrome sign that advertised moderate rates for weary travelers, the Coral Court was a place to party after proms and other events. In 1989, it was designated by the National Registry of Historic Places in St. Louis County. All right, let's just cut to the chase. This place became a den of iniquity, a no-tell motel. Adulterous behavior was there. It offered hourly rates for romantic twists and even provided garages where you could store your cars discreetly. A loss of traffic somewhat to the construction of I-44 helped lead to the decline of the motel, which closed its doors in 1993 and was demolished 2 years later. Your turn.
Okay, let's go to some featured attraction trivia. Here we go with question one. If the Gateway Arch was a building, how many stories tall would it be? Take your best shot at this one. Number two, who remembers this? What 1980s Clayton Comedy Club took its name from a J.R.R. Tolkien character? Here's a shopping mall that doesn't exist anymore. Anchored by Famous Bar at one end and Dillard's at the other, this opened in August 1985 as part of the rejuvenated downtown, but nearly 10 years later, it was vacant as a mall. Do you remember the name? The downtown mall that barely lasted a decade. Number four, multiple choice here. Of these four musicals, which one has been staged the most times at the Muni Opera? Your choices are A, Meet Me in St. Louis, B, The Wizard of Oz, C, Showboat, D, The Student Prince. Which one has played more times than any other at the Muni? And number five, what area race venue, built in 1956 as a quarter-mile oval dirt track, had the nickname the Charlie Bowl? And I know you're waiting for the Dillon question. Here it is, number six. Which brother got stopped by the cops after he and his friends stole a parking sign at Northwest Plaza? Was it Dennis or me? All right, Dennis, tell us a little bit about some products that got started right here in St. Louis.
All right, first, let's take a 15-minute intermission. No, I'm just kidding. This is our final group of entries. This is from the Made in St. Louis chapter, one of the new chapters in the second edition of Lost Treasures.
Oh, sorry. Threatening you there. Oh, that's me. Sorry. Okay. My bad.
Although Flint, Michigan was the birthplace of the Corvette, the two-seat sports car was built in St. Louis from 1954 to 1981 at the Fisher Body Plant on Natural Bridge Road. Production ramped up slowly. It took until 1969 before the Corvette production reached 30,000 a year and until 1979 when it reached the St. Louis record of 53,000. This is a picture on the left of the last Corvette produced in St. Louis. It rolled off the assembly line on July 31st of 1981. It was the last of more than 695,000 Corvettes that were produced in St. Louis. After that, the entire production of the car was moved to Bowling Green, Kentucky. 7-Up, it was originally named Bib Label Lithiated Lemon Lime Soda. The drink was invented in 1929 by a St. Louis advertising man named C.L. Grigg. For many years, it was sold as a medicinal cure for headaches, but it wasn't called 7-Up until 1936. Although the origin of the name isn't quite clear, one theory claims that the 7 represents the drink's 7 different flavors, and the up referred to the pick-me-up effect from the lithium citrate, a mood-stabilizing drug that wasn't removed from the drink until 1948.
They don't make sodas like they used to.
Okay, I'm sure most of you have tasted this delightful dessert, Ready Whip. Whipped cream in a spray can. That was the creation of St. Louis-born Aaron S. Bunny Lappin, who in 1948 teamed up with the Crown Cork and Seal Company, which had launched the first modern aerosol spray can. Lappin pioneered the concept of aerosol packaging of whipped cream and called his product Ready Whip. While it started out being home delivered by St. Louis milkmen, it wasn't long before Ready Whip gained distribution across the U.S. And by 1951, the annual sales of Ready Whip reached $7 million. Ready Whip became such a success that Lappin won honorable mention on Time Magazine 1988 list of the business geniuses and most influential inventors in the 20th century. Here, Dan, you want some Ready Whip?
Moving on.
905 beer.
I'll have some of that.
Okay, only if you're desperate. The party begins at 905 was the popular slogan for 905 beer, a product that many remember and a lot of people would like to forget. 905 wasn't the best tasting beer, but it was relatively cheap for the penny pinchers among us. In the early 1980s, a cash-poor college student could buy a case of 905 for less than $5. The beer was named after 905 Liquors, a chain of liquor stores that once operated all over the St. Louis area. The chain went out of business in the mid-1980s, and despite a brief arrival in the late 90s, it is now a distant memory. Listerine kills germs that cause bad breath. That is the longtime slogan of Listerine, the antiseptic mouthwash, which was first formulated in St. Louis in 1879. Named for Sir Joseph Lister, who pioneered antiseptic surgery at the Glasgow Royal Infirmary in Scotland, Listerine's success largely was due to its advertising campaign, most notably the naming of bad breath as the medical condition halitosis and the social fears it provoked. From 1921 to the mid-1970s, Listerine was marketed as a preventative and remedy for colds and sore throats, claims that the Federal Trade Commission ruled had no truth. But Listerine sure was handy to have around after you had been drinking 905 beer.
Okay, we're going to wrap things up with our Made in St. Louis trivia. This is our last round of trivia. Let's get started here. Question one, the highest proof grain beverage available in the USA is produced here in St. Louis. What is the name of the brand? If you were in a fraternity or sorority, you probably know this product pretty well. It always made a great punch. In more than one way. Number two, what standard police department practice was introduced here in St. Louis in 1857. Question three. This is three parts to it. Answer whichever ones you can remember or you know. In the early 20th century, the St. Louis produced three different popular car makes, and I mean they were popular across the country. The initials of the three were D, G, and M. How many can you name? This was in the early part of the 20th century, and these were premium cars made right here in St. Louis. D, G, and M were the name of the car makers. Question four. What was McDonnell Aircraft contracted to build for NASA in 1963? And also made in St. Louis, a 1990 film shot here that featured a young executive, ad executive, James Spader, falling in love with an older waitress played by Susan Sarandon. Do you remember the name of the film based on a popular novel written by a St. Louisan? 1990 film and novel. And our last Dillon question. Which brother enjoyed sadistically throwing the family cat down the staircase over and over again? I don't think it happens anymore. Okay, everybody have their sheets filled out. What I'm gonna do is scream through the answers here. Again, if you want to be eligible for our final prizes today, make sure that you've got your team name or your individual name at the bottom of your answer sheet if you intend to turn it in. As we read the answers, check off the ones you got correct, and you're all on the honor system here, so give yourself credit for only the correct answers, and I'm sorry to say again, if your name is Dillon, or if you're part of the Dillon family, you are ineligible for prizes today. Believe me, that's about half the people here, so sorry about that. Here we go. Here's the trivia answers, and remember to add up your score. In the food and drink category, what favorite restaurant on the Hill is famous for its frozen fishbowl of beer? Rigazzi's. Number two, the late night entree, two eggs, hash browns, and a hamburger patty all covered in chili. That is a slinger. Number three, what St. Louis product advertised itself as the choicest product of the brewer's art? Who knows? Falstaff beer. All four of these eateries were found along the St. Louis stretch of Route 66. Which one was established here first? White Castle. Number five, what Vest soda product was a knockoff of Dr. Pepper? Dr. Schnee. They really went out of their way to do a fake Dr. Pepper. Which brother had so many mishaps that sent him to the Menorah Hospital ER in Kansas City that the nurses knew my name? There is a wing named after him as well there. That is Dennis. The Dennis Dillon Child Injury Wing. Here's our entertainment questions. The Hockey Blues that was a fan favorite, known just as much for his blonde hair as his play on the ice. Gary Unger, the founder of rock and roll, Chuck Berry's statue has him playing his trademark guitar. It was a Gibson guitar. Number three, the longtime TV host of St. Louis Hop, Russ Carter. What popular striptease artist had her chest insured by $50,000 by Lloyd's of London? Who knows it? Oh my God, you all know it. That's embarrassing. Evelyn West. It began as Riverport Amphitheater. It's now Hollywood Casino Amphitheater. Do you know the names in the middle? UMB Bank Pavilion and Verizon Wireless Amphitheater were the two names. They can't make up their mind. Number six. As a kid, which brother would not leave the house for any special occasion unless he was wearing a bow tie? That was me. I've gotten over it. The media, here's our questions and answers. Jack Carney made this affable talking cleaning lady into a radio star in KMOX. Miss Miriam Blue, Miss Blue. Number two, the journalist who wrote about sports, theater, film, wine, and food might be best known for his St. Louis restaurant guides, Joe Pollack. Three, in Superstore on NBC, the name of the fictional St. Louis big box chain store was Cloud Nine. Number four, the first lady of St. Louis TV with a popular children's program on Channel 5, then Channel 2, was Charlotte Peters, of course. What popular TV sportscaster gave out weekly awards for the best, the worst, and the weirdest sports highlights? Zipra Zeppa. And which brother sucked his thumb until he was 9 years old? That was Dennis. No, it was me. I had a traumatic childhood because of my older brothers. That's my excuse. Trivia answers for our featured attractions. If the Gateway Arch was a building, how many stories tall would it be?
63,
very good. What 1980s Clayton Comedy Club took its name from a J.R.R. Tolkien character? I don't hear it. Bilbo Baggins. What was the downtown mall named? St. Louis Center. Of these four musicals, which has been staged the most at the Muni? Who wants to guess on this one? Showboat. It's been around the longest. The area race venue called the Charlie Bowl was, of course, the St. Charles Speedway. Which brother got stopped by the cops after he and his friend stole a parking sign at Northwest Plaza? Dennis. And he got into a raft of trouble.
I was set up. I'm innocent, I tell you.
Made in St. Louis, here are the answers. The highest proof grain beverage made here in St. Louis, it is called Everclear. Yummy. What standard police department practice was introduced in St. Louis in 1857? You may not realize this, but it really started here. That is mugshot photos of crooks. In the early 20th century, St. Louis produced three different popular car makes, D, G, and M. Anybody want to take a guess? I didn't hear any of that. Here are the answers. Doris, Gardner, and Moon, all built here in St. Louis. What was McDonnell Aircraft contracted to build for NASA in 1963? The Gemini spacecrafts, you're right. What 1990 film shot in St. Louis featured James Spader falling in love with Susan Sarandon? It was White Palace. And finally, who threw the cat down the stairs? It was
what?
Me.
What?
Sorry about that. The cat survived. It got ran over in the middle of the street, though. No. Or let's go upstairs. We'll sign some books for you. We thank you for sharing your morning with us. Quickly, I want to thank Gooey Louie Buttercake, Lindsay Newton, Emily Underwood, Justin, David, and Josh on the AV team, and everyone here at the Missouri History Museum.
And thanks to all of you for coming out today.
Hope to see you upstairs.